Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Black Caesars and Foxy Cleopatras, a history of Blaxploitation cinema by Odie Henderson. Narrated by Odie Henderson. For Dr. Michal Oleschik and Stephen C. Boone, HNIC. Prologue. When I was a college student back in the late 1980s, I worked in a video store. Actually, I just hung around the video store all day. Since I was a fixture, the proprietor eventually gave me something to do. I stood behind the counter writing out the cards that indicated a VHS tape had been taken out by a member. Sometimes I held videos for people who asked me to put aside the hottest releases when they were returned to the store. As if predicting my future life as a film critic, I was always yelling at people who picked up movies I thought were god-awful. The best part of my job was keeping the teenagers from sneaking into the porn section in the rear of the store. This back room was made even more enticing by a pair of swinging saloon doors. A fitting accoutrement for a place that held copies of Robo-Ho and Wet Dream on Elm Street. Porn was one of the categories that set our store apart from the big chains like Blockbuster. In fact, we stayed in business because we carried several specialties that were all but ignored by big video. In addition to dirty movies, we offered kung fu flicks, shorts featuring the Mexican comedian Cantinflas, and Blaxploitation classics. Blaxploitation movies were quite popular among our black and brown clientele. Perhaps it was because, like me, they'd grown up seeing these movies on 42nd Street, aka The Deuce, or in our local grindhouse theaters in Jersey City, New Jersey. The younger folks had seen only the butchered TV prints that occasionally ran on New York City's independent television channels. And they were looking forward to finally figuring out what the hell was missing from all those choppily edited reruns of movies like Three the Hard Way. One day, a movie called Street Fight appeared in the latest delivery of new releases. It was listed in our order as a Blaxploitation film, but the cover art made it look as if it were more recent. It was also a cartoon, one that starred Philip Michael Thomas, Scatman Crothers, Charles Gordon, the first black winner of the Pulitzer Prize for Drama, and singer Barry White. They appeared in live-action human form when not portraying their animated roles. Street Fight was directed by Ralph Bakshi, the director notorious for making X-rated animated features like Fritz the Cat and Heavy Traffic. The box said it had been made in 1974, smack dab in the middle of the Blaxploitation era. Had IMDb existed back then, I would have easily discovered Street Fight was originally called Coonskin, a far more offensive title that seemed quaint when one considered the era had given us slur-filled titles like The Legend of Nigger Charlie and Freebie and the Bean. A parody of Disney's controversial post-Civil War musical, Song of the South, Coonskin really leaned into everything the Disney film had been accused of being. It was intentionally racist, though Bakshi's penchant for equal opportunity racial mockery was evident. It also created trouble with black civil rights organizations. While Song incurred the wrath of the National Association of the Advancement of Colored People, the NAACP, back in 1946, Coonskin drew the ire of the Congress of Racial Equality, CORE, which attended a screening at the Museum of Modern Art in New York City and caused all manner of havoc. The controversy was so intense that Paramount Pictures, the film's original distributor, dropped it after their offices were picketed by CORE. So Street Fight was perfect for our store. It was provocative, controversial, outrageous, and downright nasty and perverted. It was also funny as hell, imbued with the type of gallows humor that only the truly downtrodden can appreciate. One of the characters is a psychopathic, scantily clad white woman named Miss America, who appears every so often to nonchalantly kill minorities. People brought it back to the store with a mixture of shock, awe, and surprise. They told their friends to rent it, and they asked those of us behind the counter if we had seen it. We had a top rental on our hands for sure. There was just one problem. One of our co-workers was a 20-something guy I'll call T. T was the most militant black man I've ever met. I was fascinated by the things he said, and I learned many things about myself and my people from him. T didn't condemn the Blaxploitation films he rented. Like us, he'd grown up with them and had some affection for them. But there was a line with T, and certain movies crossed it with their depiction of black people. Coonskin didn't just cross the line, it drove 2 or 3 miles past it. "We cannot let T watch this movie," another coworker told me. "He will burn down the store." In hindsight, this was an exaggeration. At the moment, however, it was plausible. So we designed a system of keeping Street Fight out of T's hands. At first, it was easy. The movie had an extensive waiting list. But the more people came into the store asking T, "Have you seen this shit?" the harder it became to maintain our plan. Whenever T jumped the queue and reserved the copy for himself, a perk we all utilized, we'd somehow accidentally rent out his copy. But we couldn't keep it up forever, and my weakness was to blame. One night, I was playing keep away with the VHS cassette, and T grew tired of my shenanigans. He physically overpowered me, wrestled me to the floor, and snatched the movie. It was more a slapstick routine than a violent insurrection, but I acquiesced without much struggle, because T could have broken me in half with his pinky toe. "Please don't watch that," I begged him. "It's going to make you so mad." "Go home, Odie," he told me. "Get your ass out of here." I was certain I was going to return the next day to find a gaping, scorched hole where the video store used to be, a giant blackened void located between the quack doctor's office and the overpriced dry cleaners. Instead, I found the building intact and T inside, loading a tape into the VCR that played on the one television we had in the store. "How was the movie?" I asked him as I walked toward the counter. T looked at me with the bemused smirk he reserved whenever I said something he deemed stupid. Then he laughed. "Man, this is racist as shit," he said. "But we win at the end, so I can forgive it." But we win at the end. These words carry a lot of weight whenever I think of blaxploitation movies. These films of my childhood were double-edged swords in terms of the stereotypes they often presented. Today, I can parse the contradictions inherent in T's statement. As a child of the 1970s, however, all I saw were the coolest of heroes and the most recognizable of characters. These are people I knew from my hood, God-fearing types, outright criminals, badass little brats, and colorful hustlers. As Melly Mel said in The Message, seeing all these big moneymakers, you want to grow up to be just like them. Blaxploitation was in my blood. I wanted to grow up to be John Shaft, the bad mother shut your mouth, played by Richard Roundtree in 3 films, 7 TV episodes, and 2 remakes. When I was 3, I had a coat and hat inspired by the threads worn by Superfly's protagonist, Youngblood Priest. I knew Black Caesar before I discovered he was derived from Little Caesar. My first crushes were Foxy Brown and Cleopatra Jones. The only cops I trusted were Coffin Ed and Gravedigger Jones, Chester Himes' creations as brought to life in Cotton Comes to Harlem. And I loved Kung Fu superstar Jim Kelly with the same intensity I loved his Into the Dragon co-star Bruce Lee. I knew why all these characters mattered so much to me, because they win in the end. For better and for worse, Black people were front and center in blaxploitation, playing the heroes and starring in their own tales. It beat the hell out of cameoing as Thug No. 3 on an episode of TV's Beretta, or potentially getting one's face blown off by Clint Eastwood's Dirty Harry because he had forgotten how many bullets he'd fired from his .44 Magnum. At far too young an age, I watched with rapt attention, absorbing everything I could whenever a cousin or an aunt would take me to these movies. The theaters of the New York City area provided an escape for a shy, introverted, constantly beaten up, asthmatic kid like me. I developed a love for these films that persists to this day. It's the reason I wanted to write this book. When I started writing about the films of my youth at my blog, Big Media Vandalism, the definitive book I turned to was Josiah Howard's Blaxploitation Cinema, The Essential Reference Guide. Published in 2008, Howard's paperback guide contained interviews of some of the big, and not so big, names who had directed films in the genre, from Arthur Marx to Larry Cohen to Jonathan Kaplan. Howard's primary goal was to provide a comprehensive list of films that fit neatly into the category, as well as the films hovering around the margins that define blaxploitation. Howard does critique some of the films while giving pertinent information, such as studio year, and this is quite important, whether one or more of the filmmakers is Black. It is a very good book, an indispensable resource that I have turned to many times in the years I've written about blaxploitation. Howard's book is an encyclopedic reference. This will be a deeper dive into specific films and the history surrounding them. Since there are so many films that fall within a genre, this isn't going to be as macro as a comprehensive reference guide. Instead, I will break down the elements of blaxploitation, that is, what begat them and what they eventually begat in turn. And I'll tell the story of an influential series of films while invoking a historical and contextual perspective to trace the cinematic discipline's rise and fall. It is also important to talk about what came before, because everything in Hollywood is cyclical. Parallels can be drawn from the race movies of the 1920s to the black-themed films of the 1970s. But what exactly is blaxploitation? Is it a genre, like comedy or western, or something more fluid and harder to define? I like to describe it the way I describe the equally slippery term film noir. Blaxploitation is an era, a period of time when certain films are definitive examples and others are up for discussion and debate. I'm going to set the time frame from roughly 1970 to 1978. My birth year, 1970, was when Cotton Comes to Harlem premiered, making enough money for Hollywood to notice that, yes, black people do go to the movies. In 1977, there was a glut of films featuring black protagonists, after which they practically disappeared from the screen until Spike Lee and the Black New Wave emerged in Hollywood. Again, everything in Hollywood is cyclical. There's much to discuss, from the classic soundtracks to the stars of the era and the folks behind the camera who got their start or ended their careers in blaxploitation. I have no plans to sugarcoat, so expect profanities and some very disrespectful words you shouldn't say in polite company, if at all. As an added bonus, by virtue of being old, I can offer testimonials on what it was like to see some of these films during their first run at the forgotten movie palaces in my hometown of Jersey City and the seedier ones on the Deuce. But first, let's start with the original independent filmmakers, the black folks who did it for themselves when Hollywood wouldn't let them work in the old studio system. They set the groundwork as the originators of proving that there was a market for black movies. As we'll see, Hollywood wasn't listening yet, but these filmmakers knew the power of black characters surmounting the odds to win at the end. Chapter 1. What happened before Cotton came to Harlem? Since the silent era, African Americans have been depicted on screen in American cinema the way Hollywood assumed white audiences wanted to see them. Film historian Donald Bogle explored the depictions of black characters on the film in his book, Toms, Coons, Mulattoes, Mammies, and Bucks. The title categorized the offensive stereotypes that stretched the cinematic landscape for decades. All were character types used for the same effect, Bogle wrote, to entertain by stressing Negro inferiority. Originally played by white actors in blackface, these types were soon played by black actors like Stephen Fetchett, Willie Best, and Hattie McDaniel, the latter of whom made history by winning, deservedly, an Oscar for playing the quintessential iteration of a mammy in Gone with the Wind. Later, Hollywood added concepts like magical Negroes, sidekick Negroes, and noble Negroes, folks who, respectively, helped out, accompanied, or died for the white hero. There were also the overly religious black characters who repeatedly fell to their knees for about an over-the-top praying, as well as those whose sole job was to sing a standalone musical number that could easily be edited out of the film when it played in the Jim Crow South. Perhaps those musical numbers were a form of showing Negro superiority because, oddly enough, the cooning comedy sequences that humiliated blackness were never removed. When Hollywood wanted to capitalize on the black talent that sold records or club tickets, they resorted to the all-colored musical. Films with an all-black cast put on a show. King Vidor's 1929 film, Hallelujah, for MGM, was an early example. 7 years later, Mark Connelly adapted his Pulitzer Prize-winning play, The Green Pastures, for Warner Brothers. As offensive as that film is, with its scenes of CeeLo and fried chicken in heaven, it remains a point of fascination, simply because it depicted God and many Old Testament biblical figures as African Americans, yet only generated complaints from black critics. In interrogating that divide, historian Curtis J. Evans wrote that the play had widespread appeal for whites, in part, because it reinstated rural values that many of them had lost in their move to an urban environment. In 1943, the legendary director and Liza's papa, Vincent Minnelli, made his directorial debut with his own all-colored musical for MGM, Cabin in the Sky. Then 20th Century Fox went meta by framing 1943's Stormy Weather as a tribute to Shirley Temple's Tap Dancing Down the Staircase co-star, Bilbo Jangles Robinson. Celebrating the magnificent contributions of the colored race to the entertainment of the world during the past 25 years, read a hilariously ironic magazine cover in Stormy Weather's opening scene. It makes up for that by ending with the greatest tap dance number ever, an acrobatic tour de force by Harold and Fayard Nicholas that still earns gasps at screenings and on social media 8 decades later. The Lee's films have memorable moments featuring Lena Horne, Ethel Waters, Rex Ingram, and the aforementioned incomparable Nicholas brothers. They did more for the white folks behind the camera than for the talent in front of it. Dorothy Dandridge did receive a well-earned Best Actress Oscar nomination, the first for an African-American, for her fiery work in 1954's Carmen Jones, but it did little to help her career. In Next Entertainment 3, a documentary released in 1994 for the studio's 70th anniversary, Horne speaks with shocking frankness about how she got only the bit parts that could be left on the cutting room floor for some audiences. At least in Stormy and Cabin, the studios couldn't edit her out. She's the lead in the former and the main plot device in the latter. MGM did, however, edit out one of the numbers Minnelli shot because Horne appeared in a bubble bath, an absolute no-no as it might scandalize the audience. Running parallel to Hollywood's output was an independent thread of African-American movie makers who were employing a for-us-by-us approach and making what was then classified as race films. Race films had all Negro casts and were made outside of the studio system between 1915, when D.W. Griffith's The Birth of a Nation became the most well-known depiction of black characters, and 1950, when Sidney Poitier made his fiery debut in Joe Mankiewicz's No Way Out. Race films provided a steady stream of content to segregated black theaters. This should have proven to Hollywood early on that there was a profitable market for content, but the studios weren't financially strapped enough to consider that option yet. Oscar Micheaux is widely considered to be the first major black director-producer. He was born in 1884 in Metropolis, Illinois, and his restlessness and desire to see the world put him at odds with his father, who eventually sent him to Chicago to find a marketing job. Working there as a Pullman porter, Micheaux observed many aspects of human nature and used many of the characteristics and situations he saw once he began writing novels. Micheaux made over 40 race films, both in the silent and sound eras, starting with an adaptation of his book, The Conquest, in 1918. He followed that with his most famous film, Within Our Gates, a pseudo-response to The Birth of a Nation that was banned in some areas for being too controversial. Micheaux also made The House Behind the Cedars, which, like many of his films, dealt with a black woman passing for white, the tragic mulatto in Donald Bogle's description. This film was also so controversial the state of Virginia forced him to cut parts of it. Micheaux may be the best-known auteur from this era, but Spencer Williams' work had a more widely reaching effect. His religious treatises are a precursor to the films and gospel plays of Tyler Perry. Like the man who would be Medea, Williams wrote, directed, and starred in his films, including his most famous work, The Blood of Jesus. He also created the first all-black talkie in 1929, The Melancholy Dame. Like John Cassavetes would do decades later, Williams made bit appearances in Hollywood pictures to finance his own independent films. Race movies were the only places in the film business blacks could get non-acting jobs like writing, directing, and scoring. They didn't start to change till Duke Ellington and Billy Strayhorn composed the score for Otto Preminger's 1959 court drama Anatomy of a Murder. Ellington followed that score with one for Marty Ritt's 1961 film Paris Blues, which made him the first black person nominated for the Academy Award for Best Original Score. He lost to West Side Story. This feat paved the way for nominations in this category for Calvin Jackson, Quincy Jones, and Shaft's composer Isaac Hayes. Of course, Hayes would win a different Oscar for that Blaxploitation classic, but that's getting ahead of the story. Speaking of Oscars, Hollywood's premier black actor of this era, Sidney Poitier, became the first to be nominated for the Academy Award for Best Actor alongside his co-star, Tony Curtis, for 1958's The Defiant Ones. The same year Paris Blues is making Oscar history, another Poitier film was making Hollywood history by featuring the first screenplay written by an African-American woman, Lorraine Hansberry, who adapted her play, A Raisin in the Sun, for director Daniel Petrie. Though he should have won the Oscar of playing Hansberry as Walter Lee Younger, Poitier instead won for the sister act of 1963, Lilies of the Field. This was the first competitive Oscar received by a Black actor for a leading performance. James Besquette received an honorary Oscar in 1948 that, due to segregation, he couldn't pick up at the Oscar ceremony. Though Hattie McDaniel had received her supporting actress Oscar in person 8 years earlier, her ceremony was held in Hollywood. Besquette's was held in Atlanta. According to the Academy, Besquette received the award for his able and heartwarming characterization of Uncle Remus, friend and storyteller to the children of the world, in Walt Disney's Song of the South. Sidney Poitier in Lilies of the Field made history in 1964, but the real game changer in Hollywood happened in 1967. That year, Poitier was the top box office draw in America. It had taken him 17 years to accomplish this feat, a first for a Black actor. The three-picture achievement began in June with James Clavell's To Sir With Love, followed in August by director Norman Jewison's Oscar-winning Best Picture, In the Heat of the Night, and ending in December with Stanley Kramer's Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. Respectively, Poitier played a Guyanese high school teacher in England, a Philadelphia homicide cop named Mr. Virgil Tibbs, and a son-in-law candidate so perfect that even the Grand Duke Wizard of the Ku Klux Klan would have let him marry his daughter. Three big hits for the man who was, at more than one point during his career, the only Black actor getting leading roles in large Hollywood films. In total, his cinematic output sold 102,927,317 tickets and grossed $123,512,781 in 1967 dollars. Adjusted for inflation, that's over $1 billion. The cinematic hat trick showed the actor's versatility, even if, for the most part, he was playing some form of the familiar Poitier persona in each. Those box office numbers forced a reevaluation of Poitier, and the fledgling studio started to ask what type of people were going to see these movies. And why? Columbia did surveys asking why viewers went to see To Sir With Love, and the number one answer was Sidney Poitier. As an added bonus, the actor did the film for a modest $30,000 fee, but also 10% of its gross. His reward for that shrewd deal was $4,246,280.30, a tremendous amount of money in 1967. As an entry in the much maligned beloved teacher genre, To Sir With Love ranks near the top of the list. Full disclosure, it is my favorite Poitier movie. Seeing Poitier command and get the respect for his authority was quite satisfying when one remembers the type of roles he was often cast to play. And 1967 was all about the reimagining of the near-perfect Negroes in Poitier's oeuvre, at least until December. Sir was a bigger hit, but In the Heat of the Night is the movie that put a major crack in the white audience's comfort with a Sidney Poitier character. The plot involves a murder investigation conducted by Virgil Tibbs, played by Poitier. A Black Philadelphia homicide detective, and Sergeant Gillespie, played by Rod Steiger, the white police chief of the racist town of Sparta, Mississippi. Tibbs gets involved after white police officers arrest him on suspicion of the murder of a wealthy Chicago man. When they discover Tibbs is loaded with cash, the cops assume he's their man. After Gillespie confirms Tibbs is a cop, he has no reason to hold him. However, after seeing just how good Tibbs is at homicide investigations, Gillespie realizes he needs someone of Tibbs' talent to help him. Color be damned. Two scenes in the Heat of the Night take a sledgehammer to Poitier's old personae. In the first, Gillespie mocks his name. Virgil, he asks, "That's a funny name for a nigger boy come from Philadelphia. What do they call you up there?" "They call me Mr. Tibbs," he forcefully replies. The second scene all but obliterates the image of the polite Negro who helped those nuns and won an Oscar for it. This unexpected moment is so well known that it has a nickname, the slap heard round the world. Gillespie takes Tibbs to see Endicott, the wealthiest man in town and a dead man's enemy. Endicott's thoughts on race relations are represented by the racist lawn jockey that greets the two men before they join him in his greenhouse. Feigning ignorance, Tibbs asks about the orchids. Endicott takes him to some more admirable examples of the plant. Using an overly polite tone of voice, the rich man compares these orchids to black people. "You should prefer the epiphytics," he says. "Like the nigra, they need care and feeding and cultivating, and that takes time. That's something you can't make some people understand." Endicott abandons his Southern gentleman act when he realizes that Gillespie and Tibbs are there to question him about their case. How dare this police chief bring this uppity Negro in here to disrespect him? When Tibbs asks for his whereabouts on the night of the murder, Endicott hauls off and slaps him in the face. Immediately, Tibbs returns the favor. It's so spontaneous that it feels improvised on the spot. But Poitier would not have made the movie if that reaction wasn't in the script. In my life, whether I'm a detective or not, and I don't care where I am, if such a thing happened to me, the likelihood is I would respond, he told AFI, and my response would certainly not be to absorb it. This was the first time in an American movie that a black man had slapped the white man back, director Norman Jewison wrote in his book, "This Terrible Business Has Been Good to Me." And that fact added to the shock of the scene. Poitier wasn't just hitting some random white man, he was slapping the piss out of the entire way of life. Black audiences went batshit. They had been waiting forever to see this new side of Sydney. Unfortunately, the release of Stanley Kramer's Guess Who's Coming to Dinner in December of 1967 brought back the old Sydney. Poitier co-starred alongside Spencer Tracy, Katharine Hepburn, his In the Heat of the Night co-star Bea Richards, and Wheezy Jefferson herself, Isabel Sanford. Hepburn's niece, Katherine Houghton, plays her daughter, Joey, the white woman who brings him home to her parents and tells them she's going to marry him. What is supposed to be a thoughtful investigation of interracial love instead turns out to be Poitier's worst movie. He and Houghton have zero chemistry. Poitier's John Prentice is as practically perfect as Mary Poppins. And willing to spout the ridiculous words of William Rhodes' unbelievably clueless Oscar-winning screenplay. The insulting, unrealistic scene where Prentice tells his father, "You see yourself as a black man, I see myself as a man," would have in reality resulted in Papa Prentice stomping a mud hole in his son's ass. Of course, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner made the most money of Poitier's three 1967 films because it had the version of film white audiences loved the most. But with several cities hosting race uprisings in the summer of 1967, black audiences were tired of seeing the old studio system iteration of Hollywood's biggest black star, even if he were doing more action-oriented roles. As a result, Poitier's next films were not successful, and he moved back to the Bahamas for a few years. One of those black folks who was definitely sick of seeing Sidney Poitier movies was future filmmaker Melvin Van Peebles. When asked what movies featuring blacks he disliked, he replied, "Every damn last one of them." Van Peebles had been in France for 8 years before he made his full-length feature debut with The Story of a Three-Day Pass, which he adapted from his own French-language novel. Like Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, this story features an interracial romance between a black soldier on a titular leave in France and a white woman, except here, the leads, Harry Barrett and Nicole Berger, have endless chemistry, and the movie isn't afraid to let us know they're going to have sex. Though early in his career, Van Peebles' trickster tendencies are in full effect. He plays jungle noises in a romantic scene at one point, allows his characters to have fantasy sequences, and scores the film with his own avant-garde musical compositions. He also executes a double dolly shot 2 decades before Spike Lee made it his trademark. Van Peebles' biggest feat, however, is learning a language he didn't know, writing a book in that language, and then adapting it as a movie. In 1957, Van Peebles had been thrown out of San Francisco, where he worked as a cable car gripman, over a discrimination suit. His desire to make movies sent him to Paris, where authors could be given a director's card so they can direct their own adaptations. On October 21, 1967, Van Peebles obtained a bit of sweet revenge. The city that wouldn't allow him to make movies showed one of them as part of the new director's sidebar of the San Francisco Film Festival. Thinking he was French, and therefore white, the festival handlers and employees were stunned when he disembarked from the plane. He was offered a limo and taken to the Mark Hopkins, a hotel he wouldn't have been able to stay at back in the 1950s. On a day the story with 3-day pass was shown at the Masonic Auditorium, more than one person mistook the director for a maintenance man. Everybody knew who he was once the end credits rolled. The screening went very well, and suddenly, Melvin Van Peebles was all over the newspapers. Festival of Honor for Ex-Grip Men, read the headline in the San Francisco Examiner. In the article, Gene Miller wrote, "There are certain minor flaws in the film, an artless simplicity, and certain unpolished quality. But curiously enough, they serve to point out Van Peebles' distinctive style and the raw vigor of his concept." In the same periodical on October 29th, the director was interviewed by Stanley Eichelbaum. He called the story of a 3-day pass an engaging comedy about a Negro, written and directed, for once, by a Negro. Eichelbaum had some unusual observations about the filmmaker, writing that, at 35, he seems to have overcome the bitterness that a ghetto upbringing inevitably instills in a Negro. He also mentioned that he was surprised at Van Peebles' confident and exuberant sense of success. The article ends with the journalist asking if the expatriate director would consider returning to America. "Of course I would," Van Peebles responded, "and I'd do a picture here if I were offered one." In 1970, he'd be offered a 3-picture deal. Meanwhile, future NFL Hall of Fame running back Jim Brown was at MGM British Studios playing a role Sidney Poitier would never have been considered for, let alone offered to play. As one of the 12 criminals turned anti-heroes in Robert Aldridge's The Dirty Dozen, Brown showed off his athletic skills as Robert Jefferson, a man sentenced to death by hanging for killing a white man in a racial brawl. The plot dropped Jefferson and 11 other condemned criminals into Project Amnesty, a World War II suicide mission involving a German stronghold and the assassination of numerous Nazi officers. If the mission succeeds, the surviving members will have their criminal records expunged. Aldrich directed a murderous row of soon-to-be-famous actors and vets, including Robert Ryan, Ernie Borgnine, Telly Savalas, and Charles Bronson. One would think Brown stood out like a sore thumb among these white World War II soldiers, but audiences have already grown used to seeing the equally black Ivan Dixon on TV's Hogan's Heroes. MGM opened Dozen on the same day as To Serve With Love, pitting America's first black star against America's first black action star. Brown was also one of the first actors to play Donald E. Westlake's Parker character, doing so in the first movie to receive the R rating by the newly formed Motion Picture Association of America, the MPAA, The Split. He would also be the first of several NFL players to graduate from the gridiron to the big screen in this era, a feat first done by Woody Strode, one of the two men who reintegrated football in 1948. Defensive back Fred Williamson and occasional halfback Bernie Casey would join Brown in Blaxploitation movies where they'd co-star multiple times. Brown's Dozen co-star John Cassavetes would be instrumental in breaking the directorial color barrier in Hollywood. Gordon Parks, the famed life photographer, had written a semi-autobiographical novel about his adolescence in his hometown of Fort Scott, Kansas. Published in 1963, The Learning Tree had a fan in Cassavetes, and the independent filmmaker thought its author should bring it to the screen. Parks had directed 2 documentary features, but had not done any fiction films because there was no such thing as an African-American director in white Hollywood. Cassavetes suggested he set up a meeting between Parks and Kenny Hyman, the head of Warner Brothers 7 Arts. This was in 1968. In 1967, however, Parks unexpectedly ran into his old pal Melvin Van Peebles on the Champs-Élysées in Paris. "I was the next nun," Parks revealed to Warrington Hudlin in the 2005 Starz documentary Unstoppable. Van Peebles invited the ex-nun and his friend to a screening room so he could show them the story of a 3-day pass. "It cost me $1 million," Parks joked, mocking Van Peebles' penchant for demanding payment for anything he did. Seeing a black auteur write and direct the film got Parks thinking about adapting his own material. "You gave me hope," he told Van Peebles. So, Gordon and Parks took up John Cassavetes on his offer. Hyman told him he loved the book, then asked who should write the screenplay. When Parks had no suggestions, Hyman offered him the job. He accepted. Then Hyman offered Parks the scoring job, which he also accepted. When the directing and producing jobs are thrown in, two historic positions, Parks automatically said yes because "I wasn't buying a word he uttered." But the studio head wasn't kidding. With this deal, Gordon Parks became the first debut director since Orson Welles to have this much power, and he was about to become the first black director and producer on a Hollywood film. Hyman introduced Parks to some potential line producers who would help him learn the business. One of the candidates, Bill Conrad, wanted no part of this process. "The silent one, a large, heavyset man, avoided me as though I had lice," Parks remembered in his memoir, A Hungry Heart. Despite being warned of how difficult Conrad could be, Parks hired him anyway. "Don't ask me why I made that decision," Parks wrote. "Perhaps I just wanted to be his boss." Conrad lived up to his reputation, at one point challenging his superior's authority and losing the battle. But in the end, it was a productive partnership. Conrad even helped with the casting, suggesting Dana Elkar for a role. Elkar's audition was him bursting into Parks' office, pleading, "I'm him. I'm Kirky. Can't you see it? I'm the one for the part. I'm your ornery killer sheriff." Kirky was a nasty piece of work, a racist officer who shoots several black men in the back. At one point, he makes Newt, the film's young stand-in for its director, dredge one of those dead bodies from the bottom of a lake. It's a juicy role, and as Elkar predicted, he is perfectly cast. The Learning Tree had one of still photography's greatest legends behind the camera, and he was aided and abetted by one of the great cinematographers of the era, Bernard Guffey. Guffey was a master of black and white cinematography, with 5 Academy Award nominations and 1 win for Best Cinematography, Black and White. He shot film noirs like Don Siegel's Private Hell 36, Nicholas Ray's In a Lonely Place, and Joseph H. Lewis's So Dark the Night. He won the Oscar in 1954 for Fred Zinnemann's From Here to Eternity. One would think that a color film like The Learning Tree wouldn't be his speed, but Guffey had proven himself equally adept at that type of picture, winning the Oscar for 1967's extremely vivid Bonnie and Clyde. As an added bonus, Guffey started his cinematography career in the same decade The Learning Tree takes place, giving him a firsthand knowledge of what the era looked like. Parks shot The Learning Tree on location in his former hometown of Fort Scott, Kansas, the basis for the novel's fictional town of Cherokee Flats. The townspeople at first were hostile toward these interlopers dredging up the past. They eventually came around after the mayor gave them a talking to regarding how much money the town would make from the film being shot there. Some of the most vociferous townspeople even became extras. "Entering Fort Scott was like driving into my past," Parks wrote. "The childhood I had spent there had dissolved into a blur of memories, some good, some bad." That feeling is reflected in the finished product. A film where the dignity of the African-American characters is powerfully felt and their dreams, fears, and wishes are thoroughly inspected. Hollywood had rarely given such rich interior lives and complex backgrounds to black characters, even those played by Sidney Poitier. On the first day of shooting, Parks went to Nichelle Star Trek's Lieutenant Uhura Nichols' son, Kyle Johnson, the actor who would be playing 14-year-old Newt, and told him, "Well, Kyle, I lived it and wrote about it. Now I'm turning it over to you. Good luck." Johnson did a very good job experiencing the pangs of first love, the death of a family member, rampant racism, young friendship, and learning a lesson in doing the right thing despite the odds. In a scene that coincidentally links this film with a similar, far more explicit and controversial scene, in Melvin Van Peebles' 1971 masterwork, Sweet Sweetback's Baadasssss song, Newt is deflowered by a much older sex worker. The Learning Tree opened in New York City on August 6, 1969. The New York Times gave it a mixed review, complaining about its cliché sentimentality but enjoying its images, saying the film is rich, distanced, cool, and sophisticated in its appreciation of formal visual properties. Peter Davis Dibble of Women's Wear Daily called it Great Baby Great, a play on your film's original discarded title, Learn Baby Learn. Anne Guarino in the New York Daily News gave it 3 stars out of 4, calling the film a welcome change of pace from the exaggerated violence concocted lately for screen consumption. Surprisingly, Ebony and Jet, two of the biggest black magazines in America, had nothing to say about The Learning Tree. They completely ignored the film, upsetting Parks greatly. The Learning Tree kicked open the door for African-American writers and directors in Hollywood. Before Gordon Parks made his next film in 1971, 3 more directors would sit behind the camera to helm films in 1970. What will it be in 70? A great event occurred in 1970, one that shook up the computer world. No, it's not my birth. Although that happened this year, Unix time reached its epic on January 1st, 1970. This is a rather useless detail for anyone listening to this book who isn't, like its author, a techie. However, we've got to start somewhere, and the Unix epoch, or the time from which all Unix computer timekeeping is measured, is a symbolic beginning. It started at midnight on New Year's Day, and the Blaxploitation era's epoch occurred on May 27, 1970, with the opening of 2 films. One of those would make enough money to convince Hollywood that black folks would come out to see a film about themselves. But I'm getting ahead of the story. These introductory chapters at the beginning of each year's section are intended to give a lay of the land, a sort of primer on what else is going on in the world while Blaxploitation films unspool for their audiences. They also give me a chance to ramble on outside of the more rigid constraints of the more formal chapters. So let's set the stage by first describing what happened 17 days before the epoch of Blaxploitation. On May 10, 1970, the last film by legendary Hollywood director William Wyler was playing at the Hudson Mall Cinema in Jersey City. Wyler hadn't technically directed a Blaxploitation movie, but his film did have several components that might allow it to be grandfathered in. The Liberation of L.B. Jones starred Roscoe Lee Brown, Gaffet Cotto, and Lola Falana, 3 names that will pop up more than once later in this book. Wyler's swan song was a nasty piece of work, filled with interracial sex and racial violence, including a castration. Columbia Pictures, the distributor of this junk, passed on Robert Altman's MASH, which featured future Blaxploitation legend Fred Williamson, because according to the studio, people don't say the word fuck in Columbia Pictures. Maybe not, but their Church Lady logo apparently didn't mind genital mutilation. For some ungodly reason, my mother went to see The Liberation of L.B. Jones on a day she went into labor with me. At least, that's the story I've been told. And if that part isn't true, I'm going to print the legend. This part is indisputable, however. I was born 2 weeks earlier than Mom's due date. To be exact, I was supposed to be born on May 27th, the same day as the film widely considered to be the first Blaxploitation movie was released. See? The story did have a point. This year marked the end of the turbulent 1960s, a decade populated with violent uprisings, civil rights struggles, and numerous assassinations. President John F. Kennedy and his brother Robert were shot and killed, as were Malcolm X, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and Medgar Evers. The first year of the new decade had its own infamous shooting, this one at Kent State, where 4 people were killed by the Ohio National Guard. Huey P. Newton, co-founder of the Black Panther Party, was still incarcerated after being charged with the voluntary manslaughter of Oakland police officer John Frey in 1967. Free Huey was still a rallying cry, at least until his release in August. Members of the Black Panthers went to China and North Korea in 1970. They also visited North Vietnam that year while the Vietnam War was still raging. Newton's fellow Black Panther and deputy chairman, Fred Hampton, had been murdered by the Chicago Police Department on December 4, 1969, shot up while he slept during an illicit raid facilitated by double agent William O'Neill, who provided the layout of Hampton's apartment. In 1970, survivors of that massacre and relatives of Hampton sued Cook County, Illinois, and the federal government for $48 million over civil rights violations. The case wouldn't be settled for another 12 years. The top dog in the White House in 1970 was a Republican, a feature that would be consistent during Blaxploitation's heyday. The GOPer in question was Richard Milhouse Nixon, the former two-time vice president whose ascendancy to the Oval Office was temporarily derailed by JFK in 1960. If ever a caricature of frequent Blaxploitation enemy, the man, could be personified, it would have been Nixon. Along with future President Ronald Reagan, who combated the Panthers' blatant use of open carry by creating the anti-gun legislation Mumford Act, he was no friend of black people. Curtis Mayfield and Stevie Wonder would write songs about how unpopular he was. Cinematically, Nixon would make an appearance in effigy as a mask worn by black robbers in the 1971 Sidney Poitier movie. Reagan's face would do the same in Catherine Bigelow's 1991 heist film, Point Break. Nixon also showed up in 1974 as a visual punchline in the office of a Republican politician played by, of all people, Roscoe Lee Brown. In September, comedian and native of my hometown of Jersey City, Flip Wilson became the first black person to host a successful variety program. His eponymous TV series ran on CBS for 4 years and, for a time, was the second most popular show on television. Wilson's crossover appeal was huge, earning him 2 Emmys and immortalizing his most famous character, the sassy black woman Geraldine. Like Tyler Perry's Madea, Geraldine was quite popular, and her catchphrase, "The devil made me do it," was everywhere. Geraldine would also help Wilson win the Best Comedy Recording Grammy in 1970 for the album The Devil Made Me Buy This Dress. Though primarily in television, Wilson would make a Blaxploitation appearance in that same movie where Roscoe Lee Brown was caping for Nixon. In that film, Uptown Saturday Night, he emulated another of his famous TV show characters, a preacher with questionable tactics and comments. Ron Howard got a hit movie out of the event that occurred on April 11, 1970. The Apollo 13 lunar mission began on that day. James Lovell, John Swigert, and Fred Hayes didn't make it to the moon like their predecessors on Apollo 11 and 12. Astronauts did succeed in 1970, however, when Gil Scott-Heron's classic Afrofuturism poetry slam, Whitey on the Moon, was released. Also in April, Midnight Cowboy became the first and only X-rated film to win Best Picture at the Academy Awards. Its editor, Hugh A. Robertson, was the first black person nominated in that category. Robertson didn't win, but by chance, that same month his next project was set in motion. Ernest Tiedemann published a book about a black detective named John Shaft. Shaft would be optioned by one of the numerous Hollywood studios in dire straits in 1970, Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. For now, however, there were two other literary detectives who would kick off Blaxploitation, Chester Himes' Coffin Ed and Gravedigger Jones. Director Ossie Davis was about to prove to Hollywood that black characters could captivate black audiences without necessarily leaning on crossover appeal. Chapter 2. Ain't now, but it's gonna be. And I thought I was writing realism. It never occurred to me that I was writing absurdity. Realism and absurdity are so similar in the lives of American blacks, one cannot tell the difference. Chester Himes. Born in Jefferson City, Missouri in 1909, Chester B. Himes grew up in a middle-class family. His father was a college professor and his mother a teacher. Their focus on education led to Himes attending Ohio State when his parents relocated to Cleveland, Ohio in 1925. After being expelled for some kind of fraternity prank, Himes turned to a life of crime that would land him a 20-year bid in jail, of which he would serve 6 years. While incarcerated, Himes started writing fiction. He saw it as a way to stay out of trouble. His published articles impressed the guards at Ohio Penitentiary, and the novels he wrote once he got out of jail ranged from autobiographical stories about racism to a candid take on homosexuality. A wide streak of pitch black humor runs through his work, often existing side by side with harsh, brutal violence. Characters in Chester Himes' novels knew the streets and often used that knowledge to execute all manner of side hustles and schemes. many of them with fatal results. Himes is best known for his Harlem detective series, 7 novels and 1 unfinished work that feature Harlem-based police detectives Coffinhead Johnson and gravedigger Digger Jones. 3 books from that series were adapted for the screen, For Love of Imabel, which became Bill Duke's spectacular 1991 film A Rage in Harlem, Come Back Charleston Blue, and Cotton Comes to Harlem. There was also a very loose adaptation of Himes' debut novel, If He Hollers, Let Him Go, adapted in 1968, thereby making it the first of his works to hit the screen. It counts despite so many deviations that the source material is unrecognizable outside of the title and having starred the actor who would also play Coffinhead, Raymond St. Jacques. In March 1969, Ozzie Davis was tapped to direct the aforementioned adaptation of Cotton Comes to Harlem for famed producer Sam Goldwyn Jr. This made Davis the second African-American to helm a Hollywood film. He also did the screenplay adaptation with Arnold Pearl and cast Godfrey Cambridge as Digger and Raymond St. Jacques as Coffin Ed. United Artists gave him a $2 million, that's $16 million in 2023 money, budget. This is something I've been dreaming about doing for some time, and at last we're doing it, said the man whose dad, Sam Senior, put the Goldwyn in Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. Unlike Kenneth Hyman, Goldwyn didn't ask Davis to score the picture. That went to Galt McDermott, whose musical, Hair, was in its second year of introducing blue-haired Broadway theatergoers to the age of Aquarius. Davis did, however, contribute the lyrics to the film's opening credits song, Ain't Now But It's Gonna Be, sung by the loudest soul singer this side of Patti LaBelle, Melba Moore. Her opening line is, Ain't now, but it's gonna be, black enough for me. Throughout the film, characters ask one another, Was that black enough for you? I came into this business as a writer, said Davis, referring to his career as a playwright. He was more widely known as an actor in Hollywood, appearing in Sidney Poitier's 1950 debut, No Way Out, alongside his wife, Ruby Dee. Like screenwriters Charles Brackett and Billy Wilder, or Brackett and Wilder, as they were colloquially known, Davis and Dee were inextricably linked professionally and in the hearts of fans. They were always referred to as Ozzie Davis and Ruby Dee by black folks, as if it were one word, one powerful entity of talent. Dee encouraged Davis to accept the directing job, knowing that he would be a great fit for the material's broad comedy and his intimate knowledge of the hustles, joys, and dangers that populate a black neighborhood. Davis's biting 1961 satire, Poorly Victorious, proves she was right. It's a kindred spirit till Cotton Comes to Harlem, sharing numerous plot elements even though it takes place in the boondocks of the South. There's a preacher involved in a monetary scam, a motley crew of memorable characters surrounding him in the neighborhood, and a fearless level of black humor, with a capital B, that is, that knowingly sticks one toe over the line of respectability. And they both have Helen Martin and Godfrey Cambridge. The latter received a Tony nomination for his performance as Gitlow Judson, the resident trickster who plays dumb just to get one over on the white man. Davis assembled his Broadway cast, minus Martin, and wrote the screenplay for director Nicholas Webster's little scene 1963 film adaptation, alternatively titled Gone Are the Days. This marked the movie debut of Alan Alda, recreating his role as Charlie Cutchapi, son of the wealthiest and most racist man in the county, Stonewall Jackson Cutchapi, played by Sorrel Book, a.k.a. Old Cap'n. When the movie begins, the elder Cutchapi is dead, resulting in the first integrated funeral in the sovereign segregated state of Georgia. His funeral was presided over by Charlie's childhood friend, Reverend Purely Victorious Judson, played by Davis. Judson states that old Cap'n Cotchapi was brave enough to die standing for what he believes in, and it is the wish of his family and of his friends that he be buried likewise. His coffin is indeed wheeled into the once all-black Big Bethel Church standing up, the same position in which its inhabitant met its maker. The coffin is adorned by his hat, the Confederate flag, and the bullwhip that old Cap'n used on several members of Big Bethel Church's congregation, all of whom are happy to sing him off to his rightful place in hell. Adding to the absurdity, there's a metal pin to the coffin. From there, Gone Are the Days flashes back to show what led to this joyous event. The story takes place in the Jim Crow South, where numerous blacks work on the Cutchapi Plantation has settled debts with old Cap'n that they will never be able to repay. To this plantation returns Reverend Pearly. His mission is to underhandedly obtain an inheritance that is rightfully his. The plan is to use his country bumpkin sweetheart, Lootie Bell, played by Ruby Dee, to impersonate a cousin whose mother, by virtue of working for old Cap'n Kotchapi, is entitled to a $500 inheritance. Since those relatives are deceased, Pearly is next in line for the money. The Big Bethel Church is up for sale, and he wants to buy it. Old Cap'n, however, wants to buy the building and burn it down. As expected, everyone's plans go comically awry. Davis and his company are playing stereotypes, but Pearly and his cohorts are putting on an act in order to keep those in power oblivious to just how smart they really are. As Cap'n Kotchapi's self-proclaimed favorite darky, Cambridge's Gitlow has the most incendiary lines to say, many of which would have been played as straight cooning in a Hollywood production, but Cambridge's delivery lets his audience know that this is all a ruse to deceive a white character who would never consider that he was being played. Some of the best pretending in the world is done in front of white folks, Pearly says. Gone Are the Days was rare in that it was a comedy featuring African-American performers whose characters were the main focus of the material. Black characters were used as comedic relief in white films and racist relief at that. Films featuring black leads like Sidney Poitier or Harry Belafonte were most often dramas dealing with racial strife and issues. So it was notable that Cotton Comes to Harlem was a comedy made by, for, and featuring black people. According to Cambridge, it was the first major motion picture to be made within and about the black American lifestyle that is concerned mainly with entertaining and not with preaching equality. The main antagonist of Cotton Comes to Harlem is also not preaching equality. Reverend Deke O'Malley, Calvin Lockhart, is evangelizing a Back to Africa movement that promises investors a guaranteed seat to the motherland on a boat named Black Beauty. The poor denizens of places like Detroit and Chicago have already lined O'Malley's pockets with money. And now he's extending the opportunity to the residents of Harlem, many of whom believe he's on a level. One such believer is Uncle Bud, a junk man played by stand-up comedian Red Fox, in what is clearly the origins of his Fred Sanford character on the sitcom Sanford and Son. Uncle Bud gives every penny he has to the cause. Perhaps the only people who see through Deke O'Malley are Coffin Ed and Digger. Coffin Ed, the bad cop in his good cop, bad cop pairing, wants to beat O'Malley senseless for scamming his own people. You could have been the next Marcus Garvey, he says to the preacher at one point. Before the heroes can arrest O'Malley, a gunfight breaks out. It is the first of several sharp, abrupt veers from comedy to violence, faithfully keeping the same shifts in tone as Himes' novel. Several people are shot, cars explode, Coffin Ed and Digger have an unfortunate mishap with a watermelon truck, and a bale of cotton flies out of one truck and onto the streets of Harlem. Uncle Bud obtains it and sells it for $25, only to buy it back for $30 when he discovers what might be in it. What would a bale of cotton be doing in Harlem is a question asked by several characters in the film. Those who know why also know that there's $87,000 of the faux Back to Africa movement's money hidden in it. Deke O'Malley is aware of its presence. He saves the attempt on his life. But once the cotton goes missing, he's stuck in Harlem trying to find it. When his right-hand man is accidentally killed in a planned melee, O'Malley shacks up with his widow, Mabel, in order to evade Digger and Ed. Assisting O'Malley, at least initially, is his girlfriend Iris. Played by Judy Pace, Iris is one tough, smart, and very violent cookie. The spirit of Himes' turn-of-the-dime prose lives in Pace's performance. She's a real sweetheart until she's crossed and becomes vengeful. The film uses her in comedic fashion at first, in a scene where she pretends to seduce the goofy white cop assigned to keep watch over her. The officer winds up locked out of her apartment stark naked, except for a paper bag on his head. But later, in a fit of jealousy, Iris ruthlessly smashes a model of Black Beauty over Mabel's head, nearly killing her. In a film full of machine gun-toting baddies, the mafia, and other associated riffraff, Iris is the most unpredictable criminal and the most dangerous. Harlem will become the setting for many a Blaxploitation film, but in 1969, it was a new cinematic location. The days of when white audiences would go uptown for all colored entertainment were long gone. Like much of New York City, Harlem had fallen into disrepair, exacerbated by poverty and redlining. Davis pointed this out in an interview. "An entertainment about Harlem at this time is revolutionary," he told Newsday. "Harlem has been an example of oppression, a symbol of what remains to be done. It has also been an example of the exotic, the quaint, the different, how Black people live." The characters and situations in Cotton Comes to Harlem bear out that latter example. From the old woman who keeps her money under her dress, to the stripper whose batshit musical number at the Apollo Theater features a mammy caricature dancing atop that newfound bale of cotton, Davis's Harlem is filled with weird, funky people, heretofore unseen in mainstream movies. They're hustling, having fun, and not as gullible as they appear. When O'Malley fails to deliver, his wrong constituency seek him out. His ultimate violent fate is a pointed commentary on prosperity preachers and the congregations they fleece, as well as the level of police brutality allowed in service to catching the bad guys. Coffin Ed and Digger's methods are at times as brutal as those of Dirty Harry or the French Connection's Popeye Doyle. Speaking about the toughness of his cop protagonists and their snarky sense of humor, Davis said, "We are creating a totally new stereotype to replace one that has become obsolete." He was referring to the prior history of the shuffling coons and toms Hollywood turned out for decades. Black audiences welcomed this change, coming out in droves. As a result, Cotton Comes to Harlem became the 22nd highest-grossing film of 1970. Hollywood finally took notice that Black folks did indeed go to the movies. As a result, Cotton Comes to Harlem is widely considered the first Blaxploitation movie. Cotton Comes to Harlem wasn't the only comedy featuring Black characters to appear in 1970. Jumping on the Black director bandwagon, Columbia Pictures signed Melvin Van Peebles to direct Watermelon Man, the only film he'd make in the studio system. It was based on a script called The Night the Sun Came Out in Happy Hollow Lane, written by a white writer, Herman Rauscher. 1 year before he struck gold with his novel Summer of 42, the studio was afraid that the subject matter would cause controversy if a white director tackled this racially incendiary story. The plot fit Van Peebles' penchant for sly satire and daring provocation. Rauscher's script tells the story of Jeff Gerber, a white bigot who inexplicably wakes up Black one morning. The resulting color change wreaks all manner of havoc on his daily life. At the end, he wakes up from this nightmare and triumphantly returns to whiteness, fully aware of the Black man's plight and bursting with empathy for his compatriots of color. Finally, he would understand the Negro problem his liberal wife keeps nagging him about. Despite their timidity at having a white director shoot this material, Columbia wanted an established white actor in the lead. They floated
Jack. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.